Like they always say, pretend we're not here. And, we'll that was unkind. We're here for Washington Word. Does anybody not know how? No, okay. Something familiar. Body allergy. Does everybody know how Washington Word goes? Questions about your creative process. So if you have questions about your creative process, I'll be happy to talk with you about your own individual creative process. And we have speakers behind the camera. We have folks watching online as they do every time we do this. And I'm just going to tell them how to get in touch with us should they need to.
So you can get in touch with us with some questions if you want by tweeting at WatchMeWorkSLP. And hashtag HowlRound, which is HOWLROUND. And there's a new thing.
Oh.
You can actually use the chat feature on the video chat. There's a little chat bubble when you go to the thing. It's super cool.
And they can, like, talk? Or
yeah, they can, no, they can still type.
Oh.
But, yeah, you can type it into the chat, and I'll be looking at that as well.
Oh, that's very cool.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Gee, well, Crystal, who is usually someone who tweets, she's actually here, which is very exciting. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
We're outing you or something. Anyway, so we're going to do that. So let's work for 20 minutes because I got some shit to do.
Sorry. Everybody was upset with foul language. All right. Are you ready, Audrey?
I'm ready. One,
two, three.
Yeah.
So hopefully we got something done. Maybe a friend of yours came in the middle of your work session and said hi. That was fun. That was Amelia Workman, who's an awesome actor, and I don't see her quite enough, so it was really nice that she stopped by. Sometimes it happens, you're in the middle of work and you get up and hug a friend, and you just get right back to it. So does anybody have any questions or, answers? No, questions about your work or your creative process, and we'll talk about
them. Remind me of your name.
Holly.
Holly, okay.
Holly.
How will I remember that? Oh, okay.
The Berry.
Oh, the Berry. Holly Berry.
Maybe I'll remember that now.
Maybe I'll remember that. And I have to say something. I have to have a little... There's a song. There's a Christmas song. You probably know all the... there's a Christmas song. So I'm
Deck the Halls, you mean?
Oh, there's
the
that one, too.
Holly.
The Holly and the Ivy.
Holly Jolly Christmas.
Oh, there's that one, too. Huh. I thought of neither of those. Holly and the Ivy.
We can make a whole playlist.
So I can remember.
Yeah.
So, hey, anything? Questions? Solutions? Answers? Retribution? Yeah! Uh-oh, did you go, let's see, did you, last time? No. Go on, I won't.
No, it's your face. It's okay.
So you went up on a mountain.
My kids make fun of me all the time.
And you lost your... And then you came down the mountain.
Uh-huh.
No. What's your question today? Because that was your question last time.
Mm-hmm. So, it's funny. When writing or trying to put a story together, it feels like... I like to call it, shards of glass. That, form a mosaic of some sort.
Oh, yes.
Shards of glass. It's all pieces.
Yes.
And so coming back to this story being that I kind of have to start from scratch, I can't really remember lots of it because I stepped away from it too long, as we all saw me cry about it. So I think my question is, how do I, even in this, it's pieces, nothing is in order.
Mm-hmm.
How can I somewhat, because even if in writing the outline or imagining,
right.
the mental, creative, imaginary work, there are like clouds, there are gaps in the story. So I feel like I've lost my way as far as even having an order of events. I know the climax, I know the end,
right.
I know the beginning,
right.
I know things that kind of lead to certain things,
right.
But not necessarily the thread. To get back on course. It's literally working in pieces and,
right.
and patches.
Right.
But it's kind of frustrating because it feels like kind of like my attention span, where it's like every which way.
Right.
Having a little bit of trouble zoning in.
And everybody knows, so we know what happened with just to summarize. Like, so Krista wrote this whole draft and then her computer. Completely crashed, and she lost the draft. It's very traumatic. So we've been trying to talk to you about, ways that you can,
overcome the mountain, literally, figuratively, emotionally.
Right.
Because we're constantly, it almost happened today. I was looking and I was writing, I was like, oh, we might cry today, just because of the personal.
Sure.
And
it's a really intense.
Yeah.
Story, the thing you're writing about, so it makes it even twice, three times, 10 times
yeah,
as hard.
Yeah, sure, yeah, yeah.
Right.
So it's just kind of while maintaining some emotional preservation,
right?
And then artistic writer frustration,
right?
Like, how do we funnel it in the right place to get to the point of making a coherent story?
I hear you. Wow. Just listening to your story again, I'm thinking, is there any way that having lost some of it is part of the story.
Having lost
the first draft.
Is part of the written story?
Yeah.
I'm going to sneak out while she thinks of that.
That's fine. You know? I mean, is there any way that could, I don't know, instead of like trying to just, you know, get over it, which is a harsh, you know, directive, so we're not to say just get over it. But I'm saying, is there any way to embrace it, to recognize the fact that you did all this work and lost it, part of the story that you're telling? And it's okay if you get sad about it. We don't. I mean, that's okay. You know what I mean?
Kind of.
As I remember the story, and it's a fictionalized account of some things that went down, but part of the sadness of this actual story was that the family in the story had done all this work, and it was as if none of it counted.
It was a racial thing that happened with the school, and like relationships kind of being marred, or new relationships being marred because of it.
That's what I'm saying. In my experience, when a racial thing happens, something goes down which isn't about you, but it's about like how you present, i.e. your race, your gender, your sexuality, whatever. It's as if all the hard work that you've done is being discounted in favor of some bullshit. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
In favor of some circumstances that are beyond your control. You see what I'm saying? Which sounds a lot, all the work you did is being just washed away. You see what I'm saying? You understand what I'm...
It's coming slowly.
It's okay. Just the connection between what's going on in your day-to-day and the story you're trying to, the fictionalized story you're trying to tell. I'm encouraging you to embrace the difficulty instead of just get over it. Somehow. Oh, ta-da, look at this. Thank you. I was just going to project for the rest of the time.
Thank you. It's very kind. Thanks, honey.
Sure.
But does that... Anyway, just as another sort of coping mechanism, not that that's going to make it all better or whatever. Also, every time there's a cloud, right? Every time you see a cloud, say, the sun's still out there. I just can't see it. You know, I want you to use what's going on with you instead of, you know, you say putting things together from pieces. Do you have anyone, have you ever seen a quilt? I know that was like a trick question, but you know what I mean? And quilts came about, you know, because people were using pieces of things. They didn't have a whole bolt of, I mean, now it's an art form, you know, and we're all like in awe of it and shit, but back in the day, you know, mostly women would do the work, would make quilts from pieces of things. No one had a whole big expanse of cloth to make something. They had a piece of this and a piece of that and a little leftover scrap of that, and all they had was a little bit of that. And they made quilts out of them. Just what you're doing is in the tradition of great things. You know? I mean, we talked about this before, but we can talk about it as many times as we have to talk about it. And your task is to persevere. Mm-hmm. And not to say that what you went through already, the real story, the reality story, isn't hard enough. But to tell it, this is exactly what used to happen. I know. But we're glad you're here. It's hard. You know? I mean, we could think, what would be easier, right? What's easier than writing? Can we think of anything that's easier than writing? Right, I know, right? Isn't it great? Like, we could all just, like, sit on our ass. Oh, excuse me. I'm sorry. That was an adult word. You should not use that word. That was my mistake. I'm sorry. I apologize.
We could just sit down and like, boom, you know what I'm saying? That would be great, you know? Or just, or complain about it a lot. You know, people do that. They sit around, they don't, you know, because they don't have the ability, you know, or the time. You know, or they're just too damn tired because they got too much else to do. But you've decided to step up and stand up and do it. You know, fortunately, you know, we don't have to like march over the Pettus Bridge anytime soon. But guess what? You know? So just, you know, you could say, I know there's a cloud there, and I can't not remember for the life of me what happened in my first draft. I'm just going to say there's a cloud there. I know there's a sun behind it. I'm just going to write cloud. You can do that. Cloud obscuring the beautiful writing that I had that I lost when my computer crashed on the mountain. Every time it comes up, you can just write that. Cloud. I know there's a sun behind it, and in it there's a silver lining because that's what I choose to believe about clouds. You know? You could also believe, oh, it's the end of the world, everything's going to go, like, become awful. Sorry, I'm limited because my four-letter words. Carmen's in the house today. I want to, you know what I mean? But that's something we can do. Like, every time you see that difficult spot, you don't know, oh, gee, I can't remember, just put cloud. Silver lining inside, sunshine behind it. Keep going. Don't let it stop you. You know the phrase, ain't nobody gonna turn me around. What do you think they meant? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I mean, this is, you know, this is like one of those times. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. What do you think they meant? I learned that off of watching TV. I don't watch TV anymore, but there was that show on TV. What's that actor's name? Vincent D'Onofrio, you know?
Oh,
that Law and Order or something?
Criminal Intent.
Yeah, he was always doing that. I started doing that years ago. I can't stop myself. I don't watch TV anymore. I don't want to pick up any more habits like that. But, you know, what do you think they meant? That's what they meant. This is. You don't have to break away and run through the wilderness toward the north, following the North Star anymore. We don't do it anytime soon, but guess what? What do you think we were preparing for? I know.
I feel like I'm on repeat sometimes.
No. You know, this is the thing. The cool thing about this class is that when one person asks a question that is very specific to what she's going through, it has a cool thing where it I guarantee you, it helps somebody else to have a conversation about it. Because that's the magic. Okay? So you, on repeat, actually, you're performing a great service because you're dealing with some really heavy stuff and allowing us to have a conversation about it. So you're actually performing a great service to the class by going through difficulty. Okay, so thank you. Anybody else have a, yeah, man, remind me of your name.
My name is Wallace.
Hi, Wallace, hi, good to see you again.
Good to see you.
Yeah.
I brought my friend with me.
Hello.
Hi. Hi there, thank you so much for coming. Oh, wow, what an honor, yay.
And another one of my friends over there.
Hey, hi, hi, how are you? What's your name?
I'm Alexa.
Alexa, and ma'am, what is
Nina.
Nina?
Yes.
Oh, hi, great to meet you guys. All right, look at you.
Yeah, well, because it's awesome, because you're awesome. So, I came here, and the reason why I was late is because I'm training for a new job, and it's like, but it's not job writing, it's a job making a living, and trying to get to where I can have a life where I can write. So I was thinking recently, it feels like I need a lot of help with like focusing my writing practice.
Right.
Right. And I was thinking graduate program, getting an MFA. I tried to get an MFA before.
Okay.
But the program really wasn't compatible with the way that I learned.
Okay.
And so I'm 51.
Okay.
So I was just wondering if you had any suggestions about how to, like, get the most out of, like, how can I best use MFA program at this to help a sort of a working person focus their writing practice, because I can't do it by myself. Like, I don't know the first thing about getting, I mean, I know some things about getting a manuscript,
right?
But, like, having a professor looking at my stuff like really critiquing it, that's what I would love to know if you could offer some guidance.
I think MFA programs can be really great in that they, or classes, put it that way, not necessarily MFA programs, because that, those are classes that will culminate in some kind of degree. Great, yay, okay. And there are a lot of wonderful programs around the city and throughout the country, which you know about. What's cool about classes is that they provide you with some kind of a shape, you know, to your process, and help your process, it encourages your process, right? And that's why classes are really good. I take classes, like I have a guitar teacher, and I go, and they teach me things, and I have, I'm going to start German classes in a couple weeks. I used to speak German as a child. Anyway, long story, so classes are great. I think the trick is to, like you said, to choose a the type of program that's going to be best suited for what you need. And I'm not so knowledgeable about different kinds of programs. I know places like the New School are more kind of, they have flexible, I think they used to, they have kind of a flexible program where you can kind of design it. CUNY also might have a cool program. I teach at NYU, but that's kind of rigid, you know? Like they take in people and lots of training and just kind of spit them out. I don't know if that's, not spit them out, but release them back into the wild, basically, which has its advantages and not so much. But I would say a program that is geared toward people who are working people and will give you lots of support and also help you see, like, okay, and when I finish these classes, when I graduate from the program, I can have some kind of community. Because I think that's the most important thing, right? A community that can give you some ongoing support. Also, doesn't have to be an MFA program again. I know back in the day, the Poetry Project used to have really cool classes. I've taken a lot of classes at the Poetry Project. You know, St. Mark's Poetry Project? Anybody know that? Anyway.
Yes.
It's like, you know, on 10th Street, on 2nd Avenue. They have a lot of cool classes, really cool community, so you can get a lot of writing done, get critique from a professor, and also read your work out loud or perform it. They used to have Poets Theater, which I used to do a lot of. So, it's tricky. It's finding a program that suits you, and if you try it once before, you know a lot about what you need and what you don't need.
Yeah, I mean, I think what I would like most with is like the prize, and that's like getting published.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've given my work to editors,
right?
And they say, "Oh, this needs more work," right?
Okay.
But then I'm really proud of what I've done.
Right.
Because you know, I've been like pushing through
for
years and years without any real support.
Right.
But I just now would like to be able to focus laser-like to say, deliver to the editor the thing that will have them saying, oh my God, you know? Because it's just like taking it and focusing it.
Right. That's a great gesture. That's really good. That's really good. Well, have you tried, have you looked into the New School or?
No, I've seen the programs like at the Burlington and the Bennington, Vermont.
Bennington, okay.
There's a school there, and then Goddard College. Those are some of the things, and then
Leslie University.
Leslie.
They have a low res for like if you are a real person.
Exactly. Breadloaf, I know. Oscar used to teach at Breadloaf.
They have summer programs, and maybe it's an ongoing thing. So those are cool. But yeah, if you're a real person, but I know, guessing CUNY, Hunter, I'm just thinking locally, which is great because you're already established in your life here, you know, to take a class at the new school, take a class at CUNY, maybe to take a class at Hunter, where they have different age ranges and different levels of professionalism.
That's the other thing. It's like having a place where I didn't feel like I was somebody's grandpa.
Exactly.
I know what you're talking about. Also, the Poetry Project. I mean, and this is someone speaking who did not go to grad school. So.
Okay. And look at you.
I took a lot of, but I did take a lot of classes. I just didn't go in the formal MFA program. Took a lot of classes at the Poetry Project.
Okay.
A lot, and really enjoyed it. Haven't taken a class there in a while, but it was really great.
Okay.
Learned a lot about writing. Was surrounded by a really great community. Did a lot of the poetry slams, and that's all ages of people do that. So. Not like it's just, you know, 12-year-olds, you know. So. Yeah,
Karen. I wanted to know, what kind of writing are you thinking of? Is it plays, books?
Epic poetry.
Oh.
Epic, y'all. We're talking about grand stories.
Oh, you're a
poet. That's right.
Oh, that's really great.
You know, we go all the way back to my ancestors. We come all the way up through time.
That's
but in a poetic form?
Yes. Yeah, in some ways it's like sometimes it can be forced, you know, but.
Do you know that there's also the Poetry Center downtown?
Oh, yeah.
Is that the one over in Battery City?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. The Poets House.
And going back to civil, don't be afraid of going back to because you're older. I went back when I was 50.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
I loved it. And kids are so nice to you.
They make you see it, they get up and
do it. Give you their seat.
I still remember the first term. They had a party at the end,
uh-huh.
A beer party, and they had a glass of wine for me.
Oh. You'd be drinking a beer. Yeah. But that's beautiful. Wow, that's going to be gorgeous.
You can also kind of create your own program by going to different classes around the city. I think what's important is get yourself matriculated into some kind of class, you know? Some kind of formal class where you pay. I mean, and it's funny, but you know, it would be like twice a week or once a week where you're actually going to register for a course at some institution or university. That would be great. Augmented, of course, with coming here, because this is free, and we love you, and you know, but definitely.
We've got something. Ashley Jenkins is writing in from online. She says, when you start writing a play and you start seeing inconsistencies, do you start all over or just get it written and go back later to fix it?
What are we saying? You see inconsistencies, do you go back? I know we're laughing. People laugh. So that's a great question, Ashley, because a lot of people have that question. I would suggest that if you're typing it, say, on your word processor, you would just say, oh, darn, in the first scene, that character's name was Octavia, and now I'm calling her Sally. Continue. You know, I would just say make a note of it and continue forward. The desire to go back and fix it is, number one, you're thinking you're going to, by the end of it, it's going to be perfect. No, you can write a second draft. Also, it's like, oh, what's that story? Lot's wife. You know, Lot's wife. You know, and they look back. They don't look back because, you know, something bad's going to happen. What happens? She turns, right, a pillar of salt. Yeah, so that's what's going to happen. You're going to be back there with a pillar of salt. Continue forward. Make notes of your quote unquote inconsistencies. And when you're finished with your first draft, then you can go back and make them all, and organize them and fix them because they need to be fixed. Okay? But yeah, that lure of going back, that's, I know people who do that continually. They rewrite the first, say, 3 pages of their play polishing it and polishing it, and they never get any further than that. So, continue. Even if it's, you're telling yourself like, oh, this isn't the greatest writing ever, who cares? Keep going. Go forward, go forward, go forward, go forward, all the way to the end, and then go back and rewrite. That's a hard one. That's a hard one.
Yes.
What's your name?
Obehi. Obehi.
Obehi?
Yes.
Oh, that's a pretty name.
Thank you. This is cool because I was there when you're at ART, and it was really, I still hold.
At ART, wow, yeah,
that was a bit ago, yeah.
Yeah, that was a little while
and
ago.
You gave me like really solid advice
on. Good to know.
I wrote it down on the gut, and I still use it. So
right,
thank
on.
You.
Oh, sure, thank you.
Thank you so much. I'm not sleeping, and I keep writing late into the early morning, like maybe 3 a.m.
Oh, you mean you actually, I'm not sleeping.
Yeah.
That was a metaphor.
No, I wasn't trying to be super poetic. Yeah, no. Physically, sleep is not, sleep is not coming. So I'm just curious. So then, I was talking to my doctor today, and she was just like, you should sleep. And I was like, I'll sleep. And right now, it's just, I think it's because, the play that I'm working on is just kind of bothering me, and I'm trying to, it's funny you're talking about that polishing the first scene because that's happening. It's like I'm problem solving.
Uh-huh.
So I guess I'm just curious, if there have been times where you're just your body is, because I know we're trying to all be healthy and everything.
Right.
And I exercise, I'm fine. It's much more sometimes just the insomnia and the lack of sleep is just not, it's just there. And I'm I don't know. I don't want to take melatonin. I don't want to, you know what I mean? I just want to calm my mind.
It sounds like you're talking situational.
I think it's situational,
right.
And
right.
It's connected to the work. It feels right now. It's
I think it's. I mean, we have to ask. Do you have a meditation practice?
I do.
Okay, good. In the morning, well, when you wake up, you don't go to sleep. But it's okay. Kind of first thing,
Early,
yeah.
When I wake up.
When you wake up.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
And when you go to sleep?
No.
Toward the end of the
actually,
evening.
No. Toward the end of the evening, when I'm trying to go to sleep, I do not have a practice.
So, what we want to do, right, especially if you don't want to take the melatonin or the whatever else is out there.
Yeah.
Or start drinking. you can up your good things. You can up your meditation practice. So you have it in the morning hours, we can say, right? Because those are the morning hours. And then you can double up and do them in the late evening hours, you know?
Yeah.
You can also, do you do some kind of physical something?
Yes.
What do you do?
I do yoga and Pilates.
Great. Okay.
And some aerobics.
That's great. To say up your meditation practice, I know that your insomnia is situational, so it will probably, change once you want to have a still mind, not just a frantic, feverish, here I am. Because, have you ever had a hamster?
Yes.
Okay, well, there you go. You don't want to be a hamster on that wheel. Or, Banksy's in town. Did you see that on 14th Street and 6th Avenue? You see the clock on the corner? On 14th Street and 6th Avenue, there's that clock in that sort of abandoned bank. You see the abandoned bank? So Banksy's got, he put a rat in that clock.
Yep.
It's really badass. So there it is. You don't want to be like that.
Got it.
Right?
Yeah.
You don't just want to be frantically scrambling. You want to have a clear mind. And then it will probably taper off, right, and change, because it's not a problem you have all the time, right? Funny that your doctor would say that. But it's exciting that you have work you're so excited by that you want to stay up and work.
Yeah.
Because the opposite, of course, would be someone who comes in and says, I can't seem to get any work done because I wake up in the morning and I'm sleepy. And I always want to go to bed and be, I'm tired all the time. And that's,
Yeah.
that's a difficult place to be. So it's good that it's not that.
Thank you.
But watch your, monitor yourself.
Yeah.
You know?
That's good. Thank you.
Oh, yes. Is
it
all? Yeah.
Yeah. I really love what you said last time about how close or how far you are from your
Right.
That was a while
ago. Right. Yeah.
That was one of the last
there.
Ones that
yeah.
was here.
Right.
So thank you. That was really helpful. Something I notice in my writing is I have my own identity and my own voice and my own values and politics and point of view.
Right.
And sometimes I feel like my point of view can be too overt in my writing.
Uh-huh.
And I like using this tool of writing from the characters' voices versus knowing what my own voice is and finding a place to kind of park it, maybe, at the door.
Right.
But I wonder if you have any suggestions of exercises to hear kind of your unknown voice or surprise yourself more as opposed to, as opposed to just, I think a lot of, it's almost, not didactic, but just writing from my own point of view and knowing kind of what I'm trying to say with my play.
Right. Uh-huh. Oh, so you know what you're trying to say with your play?
Yeah.
Oh, I never do. I never know what I'm trying to say. But I wait for people, their critics come and they tell me what I'm trying to say. And I go, that wasn't it like that. Or talk back, So I don't, I would say be more vigorous in your pursuit of other pairs of shoes to walk around in.
Yeah.
Like your shoes, probably when you take off your shoes, you probably have shoes underneath your shoes, right? So even when you're walking around in someone else's shoes, you probably still have your own shoes on.
Yeah.
So you have to really take off your shoes and your other shoes and your socks and maybe even your feet.
Okay.
And walk around in someone else's shoes. You have to really allow yourself to go there.
Yeah.
And you're still holding, like you're saying, oh yeah, I'm gonna be her, but I'm really gonna be me. So your heavy foot, the weight is still in you, right? You say, yeah, I'm gonna be her, but you're really here. You're not really there, you're just kind of, right? I mean, I think it's your best effort, but I think you can really go there.
Okay.
Because trust that you'll always get your point across, so your play will always say something.
Right.
It'll always say something meaningful and important. But guess what? It's going to be better if you're not driving.
I know that.
Right.
That's a fact. That's where my question comes from.
Oh, wow. So this is not an ad for self-driving cars, which I'm still mad about. But
yeah. I know that that's what limits. The point of view of the optic of the audience.
Yeah. So it's like you have to.
It's just figuring out where that pattern. Or the access point.
Right.
Does that make sense for the pattern of that? I think what you're saying is really useful.
Yeah. It's like you have to.
Let go. A little more.
You're holding on. And it's easier to let go if you trust. If you trust in that greater voice, the voice that is greater than yours. Not to say yours isn't,
That
voice that is greater than yours, that is somehow greater than yours, belongs to everybody, and yet is yours alone. Does that make any sense? I just made that up. I don't know. That might make sense. You know what I'm saying?
I know exactly what you're saying.
Great. So just go there.
Right. It's a little bit like when that greater voice happens, it's not because I just was like, great, I know exactly how to go there.
Uh-huh.
I guess it's something to look at. What are the situations that brings that kind of writing about?
Right. Have you ever, you've been there before?
Yeah, but not because I consciously, I don't know. I have to think about it.
Some, sometimes your characters in the greater voice, they won't make sense in a way that you can, you, Holly, that we see here now can readily identify. Sometimes I teach at NYU, my students, I wrote a scene, it doesn't make any sense, I don't know if it fits my play, right? I'm like, whoa! Don't erase it, keep it, hold on to it a minute, because that might be your greater voice talking to you in a way that you don't quite understand yet.
Yeah.
You know? So sometimes I feel like you might want to make sense as you go forward. Dare to make nonsense. Dare to stumble drunkenly along the avenue and talk to strangers. Look people in the eye who you know you shouldn't be looking at.
Right.
You know?
That's right.
You know what I'm talking about, right? Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Stare out the window. Sit at the window. Stare out the window. Look into your own reflection for a little too long. And you'll go, shit, who is that? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know? Things that allow you to let go. And I'm not talking about putting yourself in any kind of dangerous situation or anything like that, or, you know. Go on long walks, maybe you do already, I don't know. Okay, good. Look at the water. Look up in the trees. Nature has answers. Look at how, the jonquils, the flowers, the daffodils are out. Walk along the street and look at the daffodils and see how many brave flowers, you know how brave it is to come out of the ground? Shit, it could snow tomorrow. Hi, I'm here! There they are. You know, that's where it is. The answers are in the natural world, right? Or in the way kids run around, snot hanging out of their nose. Like that. There it is, you know. Become deeply interested in others. Not in a kind of save the children, I'm going to be a helpful person from the Western, quote-unquote, developed world going over to save some brown people. Not like that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But deeply interested in them. Something in a way that is not going to get you anything, but just out of your own self. I hope that works, because I was just talking out of my neck.
It's 6 o'clock.
Oh, it's 6 o'clock! Are we going to be back next week?
We're not back next week, we're back April 2nd.
We're back on April 2nd, which is the day after, which is the first day of my German class. Woo! Right. Well, thank you guys for coming. This is great. Avery's behind the camera. Audrey's here. This is watching work at the Public Theater. We love you guys. Bye. Thank you.